When enormous amounts of gas fall inside a black hole, the gas glows a lot. So much so that in the absence of light pollution, you can see it glow with a naked eye, from as far as 30 billion light years. Such objects are called quasars. But how do they work? Why does the gas glow? Well, the gas particles reach very high velocities due to the high gravitational acceleration from the black hole. And high velocities of gas particles means high friction between them, which itself results in the temperature of the gas to increase. And by the Wien's displacement law, we know that the hotter an object is, the more it glows. But there's a catch. The naked eye cannot understand the difference between a quasar and a regular star in the sky. In fact, if you don't know what to look for, you can't even distinguish a planet from a star for yourself. So how do scientists know for sure that these stars in the sky are black holes with a lot of gas falling into them, and not stars, which are stars, like the Sun? Well, I already gave a hint. Quasars are very far away. The more distant ones are 10, 20, or even 30 billion light years away. For reference, the radius of the observable universe is 45 billion light years. We measure the distance via the red-shifted light they emit, and the reason they are visible to us from so far away is because they have very high luminosities, as high as 1 trillion times that of the Sun. There is no way a regular star be so bright from so far away. The brightest stars have luminosities at most 1 million that of the Sun. So quasars have to be supermassive black holes. There is no way around that. Sometimes it is possible to also find stellar black holes with this method. Sometimes a binary system composed by a star and a black hole will shine in X-rays. That's because matter from the star falls inside the black hole, heats up, and releases X-rays. Not so bright as a quasar and not for so long, but enough to be observable from Earth. These systems are called X-ray binaries. X-ray binaries can be a star with a black hole or a star with a neutron star. But the evidence of black holes don't stop here. Another proof of black holes is the motion of stars. We can't see black holes, which aren't quasars, but we certainly can see stars. Some stars in the center of our galaxy are orbiting something. But that something doesn't emit light, and their nearby stars sometimes get really close to it. And by knowing the mass of the stars and some orbital mechanics, it turns out that that something has mass as much as 4 million suns. Well, what kind of object other than a black hole doesn't emit light and has mass as much as 4 million suns? None. It has to be a black hole, and specifically a supermassive black hole. Did you know light is affected by gravity? According to general relativity, the acceleration of a photon due to gravity is 4 times the massive object times the gravitational constant divided by the distance of the photon and the object times the speed of light squared. And this is a very small number. G is very small, 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11, and it is on the numerator, and C squared is very large, 9 times 10 to the 16, and it is on the denominator. So for a photon to be significantly affected by an object's gravity, 1, the object has to be massive, and 2, the photon needs to get really close to it. This is the explanation why you often see artistic pictures of black holes like this. To this day, however, we have never observed such an effect with black holes alone. We have only done it with either galaxies, galaxy clusters, or quasars, which have black holes in them, but they don't contribute to the total mass of these objects very much. Dark matter does. But they are predicted by the theory, so we should see them sooner or later. No black hole conversation would be complete without mentioning gravitational waves. In September 14, 2015, the LIGO team detected gravitational waves for the first time in human history. The waves were generated by two black holes spiraling and eventually merging. But could the source of these waves be anything else other than black holes, like neutron stars or regular stars? No, because the mass of these objects spiraling were 36 and 29 the mass of the Sun, and there is no way a neutron star could be so massive. The mass of the heaviest neutron star is just below 3 times the mass of the Sun, let alone 29. Could they be regular stars then? Such massive stars do exist. Again, no. Regular stars have significantly larger volume than stellar mass black holes. And if they spiraled, they would merge before they had the chance to reach high enough angular velocities to generate gravitational waves detectable by the current LIGO. This is especially true for 30 solar mass stars, which are gigantic. The waves were produced by stellar black holes, period. To this day, we have found 3 black holes with this method. But there are plans to directly observe a black hole. Yes, you heard me right, directly. How? By using radio telescopes from all over the globe and a little bit of math, a technique which is called very long baseline interferometry, we can combine images from multiple telescopes all pointing to our black hole at the center of our galaxy and produce an image with better detail than ever before. This project is called the Event Horizon Telescope, and it is going to give us a real picture of the surroundings of our black hole. Because we are tired of seeing images like these all the time, which aren't anything more than just art. Will that image give us information we don't know? Will it expose general relativity to experimental evidence of inaccuracy? That remains to be seen.